There are two very fundamental and general ways to think about SETI, inside the Milky Way galaxy and outside it. Inside it is difficult enough. The further a star is from us, the more difficult and less likely that it is we will pick up a technosignature of an alien civilization. Radio signals get weaker with distance, and so do most other indicators we can think of that might betray the existence of an alien civilization. Add in that the galaxy's clouds of dust and gas further serve to make stars beyond it not easily studied. Outside the Milky Way, it's far more difficult. There, nearby galaxies simply don't present very many possibilities in the way of technosignatures we could detect. And the further the galaxy, the further back in time we see it. And eventually you hit a point where the universe was just not old enough to have populated itself with heavier elements, making civilizations earlier than a certain point highly unlikely. But there is one technosignature that could be looked for, which comes in the form of reddening of nearby galaxies as Type 3 civilizations kick out or alter dangerous stars, and encase suitable ones in infrared-emitting Dyson spheres, if such things are possible. This has been looked for, and there were no good candidates found. So it remains a long shot that we could ever detect alien civilizations in other galaxies under normal circumstances. If we could ever move at very high relativistic speeds, and we gave up our attachment to our own time in favor of severe time dilation, then it might be possible to take long shots and travel to other galaxies in hopes of finding someone. But that level of technology is either very far in the future or forever impractical, even if the universe allows for it. So the great silence persists both inside and outside our galaxy. But there is a way to see if other galaxies might hint at one crucial point: the presence of chemicals that ultimately make up life. This is not a biosignature, rather the signature of chemistry that comprises our type of biology. From this, we might be able to rule out some galaxies as unlikely to host life. But there again is the problem of how situational the universe can be. You might have a galaxy that's unusually devoid of something like phosphorus, but might support pockets of it where life can get a foothold in an unlikely galaxy. Another issue is how dense galaxies are. High radiation environments and close supernovae do not favor life getting a foothold. But there are other potential problems, and this actually includes some of the largest concentrations of stars in the universe, the giant elliptical galaxies. This is somewhat disheartening, because with great numbers of stars come great potentials for alien civilizations, just from sheer numbers, all else being equal. But it's not. In principle, just on the numbers alone, such galaxies could have 10,000 times more habitable planets than the Milky Way. On their face, giant elliptical galaxies look good. They have low supernova rates for one, and their stars tend towards the ancient side, allowing a lot of time for the evolution of a technological species. But it's thought that these galaxies were much more compact in the past, and if so, would have been very high radiation environments, sterilizing their worlds early on. This radiation would have been provided by active galactic nuclei and early supernovae everywhere that seems to have hallmarked the early days of the giant ellipticals. This is unfortunate for another reason, which are probabilities. The chances of an alien civilization existing in the universe is such that 99% of them would be in these giant elliptical galaxies. Clearly, we're not in an elliptical galaxy, we're in a class of spiral, which might be telling. But if the giant ellipticals are off limits for life and civilizations, then the chances for alien civilizations being numerous in the universe drops dramatically. But not to zero. Rather, alien civilizations very likely exist, they just don't happen very often, and there's no guarantee they stick around long enough for anyone to detect each other. And given that we're dealing with the vast distances of intergalactic space, even if civilizations last a very long time in the grand scheme of things, they may never be able to see each other due to distance. But there is a wild card here. This may not apply to our galaxy, more on that in a bit. There may be lonely aliens out there, but we may not be in that boat. But the scenario involving giant elliptical galaxies does have one potential issue. If those galaxies went through their supernova starburst phase and the quasar phase, and with sufficient time to disperse their stars more distantly before large-scale planet formation began, then they may come back on the table as we learn more. There's a reason to think this, in that you need all those supernovas to make the elements you need to form planets. So it's a question of just how the timelines played out. On the other hand, giant ellipticals show high metallicity, which may make it more likely that they formed a lot more gas giants. But at the same time, gas giant moon habitability is not well fleshed out, but seems possible. Still, since we live in a spiral galaxy, that suggests that the probabilities of other spiral galaxies hosting life and civilizations remains better. That, however, leaves the issue of star types. By far the most common star type in the Milky Way is the red dwarf, and we're not orbiting one of those. If red, orange, and so-called yellow dwarfs, like the Sun, are all habitable, then that's not really a big deal. But if red dwarfs are not habitable, then that constrains the possibilities for life and civilizations in any given spiral galaxy even more. The good news is that while red dwarfs took a hit, as we learned that many of them are severe flare stars that might sterilize their planets in their own right, there is also evidence that they might not flare at their equators, and the giant flares may miss their planets entirely. This might make for a rather spectacular sight for any inhabitants of those kinds of worlds. At the same time, however, recent work with JWST on the TRAPPIST-1 planets does not bode well, in that the innermost world appears to have no atmosphere. But then again, our innermost world doesn't either. So the wild card here is that if you have one habitable planet with a civilization in your galaxy, which we do, us, then the chances are higher that you have many. So you might not be alone in your intergalactic neighborhood, but you might have neighbors inside your galaxy by virtue that you exist there. So even if we rule out the giant ellipticals, it has little bearing on the prospects of the Milky Way, or for that matter, Andromeda. This leads to a rather far future science fiction heavy scenario, but it's a fun one. We have two large spiral galaxies on a collision course, Andromeda and the Milky Way. And this will happen in the far future, in about 4.5 billion years. That's a long time for both galaxies to form civilizations. And by the time of the collision, there may be many in an intelligence explosion brought on by sheer time. This would be like two starships meeting, but in this case, entire galaxies. And anything from cooperation to intergalactic warfare could result, depending on the circumstances. Earth itself, however, will be in trouble either way. By that time, it will either no longer exist, having been devoured by the Sun's swollen red giant phase, or will be a cinder, or have evaporated to nothing. But the Sun may find itself ejected. In fact, it's thought that there will be about a 12% chance of ejection during the galactic merger, and the remnants of the solar system may find themselves someday wandering interstellar or even intergalactic space. If there are any humans, or what once were humans, left at the time, perhaps living in the far outer solar system, or in other star systems entirely, they will watch the ejection of their home star system slowly unfold. But there's another way to look at this. If spirals are where life is likely, but you can't search other spiral galaxies for life directly other than the red spirals, you can look at their chemistry to a certain degree. And it turns out that the Milky Way is actually somewhat unusual, but not by any means unique. The Milky Way really is the only galaxy where we can study stars up close and really characterize them, other than more generally for other galaxies. It turns out that the galaxy is rather uneven chemically. Heavier elements are rare in the rarefied outer reaches of the galaxy. Then they approach the highest levels in the spiral arms where we are, but drop again near the galactic core due to a higher percentage of old, metal-poor stars. This seems to be the case for some other nearby spirals as well, but not all, suggesting that our galaxy is unusual in its numbers in this regard, but not unique. In other words, we're atypical, even for our type of spiral galaxy. But it's unclear what that might mean for life and civilizations. It could mean that we're in a rare galaxy scenario, much like the rare Earth scenario, or it may not preclude anything as far as spirals go. This may be due to differences in how the Milky Way evolved in relation to most other spirals, but that could have been caused by any number of factors. And then there's phosphorus, a key element for life. We don't have a good handle on its distribution in the Milky Way, but some evidence shows it may be spotty. This would lead to pockets of habitability in spiral galaxies instead of entire galactic habitable zones. But if phosphorus is scarce to rare in other spiral galaxies, then that could guarantee sterility on its own. This opens up the possibility that a number of factors coming together at once might render the Milky Way very rare indeed, even for a spiral galaxy. It has to be said that other types of galaxies may also be unsuitable. Small galaxies may not have enough stars to produce the materials needed to make Earth-like planets common. And an interesting scenario is that if you're unlucky enough to live in a small galaxy with relatively few stars, your chances of being functionally alone are raised. Most stars may be in large galaxies, but most galaxies are small. Other wild cards are galaxies that experience too many long gamma ray bursts, which may contribute to regular extinction events, never allowing, at least this early in the history of the universe, for civilizations to arise. If life is rare in the Milky Way, and impossible in most other galaxies, the Fermi paradox on an intergalactic scale is resolved. If you couple that with Earth being rare within the Milky Way, or any number of other factors that make up the rare Earth hypothesis, ranging from the unlikely presence of a moon and so on, then a rare Earth within a rare galaxy means the paradox isn't a paradox, but that life and civilizations aren't favored in the universe at large. Again, it's unlikely to be alone, and indeed impossible in an infinite universe scenario, but simply very rare. But again, it pays to remember it happened here, and discoveries as of late seem to point to abiogenesis being easier than we had suspected, at least as far as RNA generation and cell membrane generation are concerned. And it's also possible that we haven't yet envisioned just how life can arise and evolve. There may be more than one way. To quote Jeff Goldblum in Jurassic Park, life finds a way. Maybe it's better at doing it than we thought. And let's not forget, all it takes is one detection of an alien civilization to change the landscape of the question fundamentally. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author Jean-Michel Godier, currently eyeing Earth suspiciously. If it turns out, if the Milky Way is rare and Earth is rare, then this planet is going to become hard to live with in a mega-celebrity sort of way if it ever finds out. And then comes the jealousy of Mars. Not good. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.